Good evening and welcome to Horizon. I'm Ted Simons. Joining me tonight are Dennis Welch of the Arizona Guardian, Mike Sunnix of the Phoenix Business Journal, and Steve Goldstein of KJZZ Radio. Well, Jerry Lewis submits signatures for the Russell Pierce recall election. How many did he need? How many did he submit?
He needed a little over 600, I think, and he got about twice that many. Another step in the process. It looks like, you know, there's going to be a recall. The only question needs to be answered now is this legal challenge to the qualifying signatures to call the actual recall. But it looks like there's going to be a November recall.
And it looks like he's going to be there. I think at this particular submission of signatures, he said that SB 1070 was a, quote, good start. I mean, how are we going to look at this? Just basically, he's not Russell Pierce?
Yeah, I think that's probably how he's going to run it. I mean, and there's more to Russell Pierce than just immigration. The opponents are going to bring out some of the other stuff that's gone on with him. I think you got to be in that district, and as a Republican, you got to be somewhat conservative on immigration. You can't be for amnesty or some pathway, and you really can't be against 1070. That's going to be a tough go if you're trying to get Republican votes. So I think he's going to try to cut the difference and say 1070 is a start. You know, who knows what his exact stance is. I don't think he said how he would have voted on
right.
provisions of it or the whole bill.
He already told me that he was a supporter of what's been called, it is known as the Utah Compact, which was supported by the LDS Church, the Mormon Church up in Utah. And it's a much more, and it calls for much more moderated position on immigration. It's against anything that would break up the family, these kinds of things. So he is definitely, I think you could say, a lot more moderate on immigration than Russell Pierce.
I think it's hinting at the church's stance in this. The church is probably going to stay neutral. I think everybody's got that indication they're not going to get involved with this. But when Lewis brings those things up, it's kind of a subtle hint that I'm with the church is with me, and maybe they're not with Russell.
But Lewis has acted a lot as a teacher over the years, so he's going to come across as that nice, mild-mannered guy. If he can afford spots, you're going to see some great TV ads of people, I learned from Jerry Lewis. He made me a better human being. No one's going to say that about Russell Pierce.
How far does he go, though, on something like an SB 1070? I mean, how far does he go to show how conservative he is, how similar he is in terms of some policy to Russell Pierce?
If he has good advisors, he won't talk about immigration very much and will emphasize the fact that Senator Pierce should have been focused more on the economy. He's a former appropriations chair. Why wasn't he focused on that? Because if he goes down the immigration path, that's really going to start some fireworks in it.
I couldn't agree more on that. I mean, you know, you've got to play to your strengths, and you know, and you can't play to your opponent's strengths. And by going to Senate Bill 1070, going at the immigration debate, you know, Mr. Pierce is going to win that every time in that district. Those voters have shown time and time again that they support that kind of a policy.
I think the big question is what kind of campaign Lewis can mount. Does he have the money? Does he have the resources, like Steve said? Does he have the advisors that's going to lead him down the right path? He obviously got more than enough signatures. That's kind of a good indication from his camp.
Sure.
But that's, you know, getting from there to November and running a good campaign against Russell, who knows how to run campaigns in a Republican district, is going to be tough.
And Lewis's job just got a little bit tougher. We had another candidate that entered the race who's offered himself up as the libertarian choice, which is interesting because in that race where you have, you know, a couple Republicans, now you have a libertarian in the mix who's opposed the 1070. So this gives a place for those types of people at that street who don't like 1070 to go, you know, so it would make it harder for someone like, you know, someone like Lewis to get that vote. Again, we've talked a lot about splitting that anti-Russell Pierce vote in that district, and that this move we saw this week kind of goes toward that goal.
I was just going to add to what Dennis said, Ted, the idea of flooding the field, and there is still a little bit more time for that to happen, and I still wouldn't be surprised. As Mike said, Russell Pierce knows how to run campaigns. His people know how to run campaigns. They're going to try to do as much as they can to make it just convoluted.
Appeals court fast-tracking now this whole election challenge. We're going to try to get this thing as soon as possible.
Yeah, they're going to have to get this thing done as soon as possible. I mean, November's going to be here sooner than you think. And I think by all indications, you're looking at the campaigns, it's not really affecting the way they're going about their campaign. They're acting like this is going to happen anyway. I mean, the chances of them striking this, you know, killing this election, this recall is, I think, pretty slim.
Low turnout. You're going to have a low turnout on this and pretty much all the races this November. How does that play? Does that help Russell, or does that maybe help Lewis if he's got a good campaign and you got an energized anti-Pierce folks out there? Maybe they turn out.
The election costs. Howie Fisher, our friend Howie, wrote about this and apparently discovered that there's some sort of constitutional provision that would allow for Senator Pierce to request reimbursement of election costs? What's going on?
Well, I find this to be highly ironic. Well, first of all, we'll say that, you know, after the election, if Mr. Pierce wins, he can request the legislature to, you know, decide whether he should be reimbursed for the costs incurred of running his recall election. Now, I find it ironic that he would be in that position, because this is a guy who has repeatedly said he does not like the state's current publicly funded finance system. Yeah, he runs opposed to that. But if he does request that and he maintains his position as Senate president, who's going to vote against it? I mean, if he requests this election to be refunded, who's going to vote against that?
I think it's kind of unlikely that he would request it. You know, he's such a small government guy. You know, as Dennis said, he's against clean elections. You know, it would kind of just go against his record and everything. And it just smells bad to everybody. The legislature and Russell have enough PR problems. Mm-hmm. If he would come back and say, reimburse me for this, I think it would.
Well,
just,
but would there be a situation where he doesn't necessarily have to ask vocally, but the legislature, because it is up to the legislature, apparently, deciding how much he gets, how he gets it, when he gets it, this sort. Hey, he survived. I think I'm going to stand. You know, wouldn't we see something like that?
Well, Ted, can I add to your cynicism and sort of go back in history as to lawmakers decided to, I mean, who came up with this idea in the first place? Let's protect ourselves if there's a recall election.
Any reaction at all from Pierce on this? Anything?
Well, and what's interesting in this whole thing is how these two candidates have been, like Jerry Lewis and Pierce, have kind of been in bunkers. They've been really quiet this whole time. It's unlike Pierce. So as far as getting reaction, you know, we haven't gotten much reaction from him.
Yeah. I think the thing about Pierce is he wants to avoid any major missteps. I think he thinks he can win it with his ground game, his name ID, send out the mailers and work the district. He doesn't want the media, national media, local media, glomming onto this and making a bigger story and digging something up that might turn the race.
Okay, let's talk about another race here, the Phoenix mayoral race. And we'll get to the substance part of the conversation, the debate, in a second. But we got to start. Well, what in the world is going on here with this smear campaign? Well, what is this all about?
About Wednesday afternoon, there was some anonymous phone recorded phone calls started going out to apparently women Republican voters in Phoenix, and there was a claim that Mr. Gullett had an affair on his wife and impregnated another woman, and that. Therefore, he cannot be trusted. The call was not identified, as law would require that if you put out a call like that, you have to identify who paid for it. Nobody knows who's behind this at this point, but it was obvious attempt of a smear tactic by somebody in this race. Mr. Gullett has called it outrageous, ridiculous, unethical, and illegal.
Yeah, all four, and probably in the same sense.
But how much does this sound like what John McCain went through in South Carolina, and the idea that both he and Wes Gullett adopted girls from the same community who are not white? So is this another sort of odd thing? But I can't even think, following this campaign as closely as I have, Ted, I can't even imagine anyone else running in this campaign. They're all friendly on stage. Would someone really allow an advisor to go ahead with this?
And that's why the thing seems awfully odd to me. I mean, this is who in the world is going to sit at home and go, I believe this. I'm not going to vote for Wes Gullett. I mean, really?
Well, I think it actually shows that maybe Wes is a lot more stronger than people thought in the race. A lot of people think Stanton will be in the runoff, and there'll be another candidate, either Neely, Maddox, or Gullett in there. And the fact that people are going after Wes on this, and they've gone after the fact that he's a principal in a lobbying firm, and he's going to stay a principal in the firm if he's elected, they've gone after him a lot. He's kind of been a target. Now, either his constituency is this key swing vote, or Wes is kind of seen as possibly the number two.
Now, to your point about who would believe this, what I found was interesting was how they handled this, because unlike McCain back in 2000, who kind of let these questions fester, Gullett was out there right away saying mm-hmm. this was ridiculous. I mean, they, you know, lesson learned from 2000, don't let these things, you know, fester out there, because then they become believable.
Well, then he put a statement out on his website, which was really interesting. You know, he denied the charges, said, you know, he loved his wife and his children. One of his teenage daughters received this call, makes it very personal. Then he had this thing about how he's a Christian, and he got that in there, and kind of just, I think he took advantage of it very well and was very adept at his response and what he said in there, because he comes across as this good family guy who's been attacked, and he creates some sympathy factor for him.
Going back to who might be behind this is an operation that knows what it's doing. They had a bunch of targeted phone lists, and you know, you guys probably didn't get a call like that, but the certain target, the focus group, they got those telephones. This is relatively sophisticated.
No question about it. This is a plan. That's why, I'm not going to say any names, but I think if we look at who runs certain campaigns and who is battling with Wescola for second place, that might give us an idea.
This is pretty tough stuff here.
I think if I'm not convinced it was somebody, you know, with one of the other campaigns. I mean, it's to talk about, you know, and speculate. That's just what it is. It's pure speculation.
Sure.
I mean, it could be someone who doesn't like McCain. It could be someone, and Wes Gullet is tied with that. I mean, who knows? It could be any number of people out there. Wes Gullet has run a lot of campaigns over the years. You're in this business long enough, you're going to make a lot of enemies.
I mean, we're not sure how many calls actually went out. I mean, it seems like it was a lot, but we're not sure.
Sure.
An interesting fact was Claude Maddox filed a complaint, too, asking the city to look into this.
Mm-hmm.
So he's coming to the aid of one of his rivals. That makes him look good. But I really think this elevates Gullet a little bit in the campaign. It puts his name out there. He's the sympathetic figure. He gets to say all these nice things about himself, and he's the victim.
But Gullet is the clear target, though, Ted. As Mike said, Stanton is going to get at least 40%, and he's going to be in the runoff.
Right.
Gullet is the only one who's put out TV ads. Gullet is seen as the one with the money, so let's try to knock him out of second place. The recent poll that I saw has Gullet and Neely neck and neck, and Jennifer Wright actually behind them, Claude Maddox a distant fifth.
Let's talk about Jennifer Wright not participating in this debate as we move swiftly over to the debate. What was said here? First of all, why did we have 4 out of 6?
The Phoenix Chamber of Commerce was hosting this debate. As of June 1st, they had set a standard that each campaign had to have raised at least $50,000 in order to be eligible. Jennifer Wright got in the race, I think, late May, so she certainly wouldn't have had time to get in there. And the chamber decided, we're a private organization, we're going to have people in who we would like to participate. So the fireworks really were beforehand, that Jennifer Wright and Anna Brennan were not allowed in, and once the debate started, it was sort of back to the same old claptrap.
Yeah, and I'll say this, I know that the KPHO was a co-sponsor on this debate. And, you know, a news station should have the public's best interest in mind. And I don't think the public's best interest was served at all by keeping two people who qualified, who followed the rules, qualified for the ballot, should have been on that debate. Because, again, if it was just the chamber that did this, if they bought the time, that's fine. You can have whoever you want on the debate. But this is a news organization that should have had the public's interest in mind.
Yeah, I think Jennifer Wright's a big wild card in this. She's a Tea Party activist. She's a little bit younger. She's a woman. She could really split the vote with Neely on this. She could siphon off votes from the other Republicans. You know, she's kind of the conservative candidate in this. And she's kind of run this kind of grassroots campaign. And maybe being excluded from the debate maybe helps her because it elevates her a little bit. Not many people watch the debate. Not many people can tell you what the candidate said in the debate besides they want more jobs and better schools and safe streets. So I think Jennifer's got a chance.
So the most interesting part of the debate was when Wes Gullet was asked about his consulting firm and the idea, and he was pretty adamant about saying, listen, I've spent 9 years building this up, and then a couple of days later, Dennis, I'll leave you with the conclusion, something else happened.
He said he was going to go ahead and divest his interest in his lobbying firm should he be elected. It's been an issue that they've been hammering him at, which is getting a little bit back to the robocall, which was interesting because we started off the week with Gullet getting hammered constantly in the mail, constantly with email and in the press about his ties to his lobbying firm. In another interesting way, this robocall kind of changed that conversation in that respect, and then all of a sudden we stopped talking about this, and then we started talking about Wes Gullet, the victim.
Let's talk about the debate a little bit here. It seemed as though Stanton and Maddox were kind of, hey, you know, the status quo is not so bad. Let's not trample on what we got. And it seemed as though Gullet and Neely were more like, we need change, we don't like the way, did anyone win or lose this thing?
I'd be shocked to say that anybody won. Greg Stanton won simply by not making a huge mistake, and he's kept his position in first place. It really, there was nothing, I hate to say there should have been an attack or something like this, but there really wasn't anything to set anyone apart. Claude Maddox came across as a very nice guy who liked being on the council, thinks the council's done good things. Mm-hmm. Wes Gullet came across as someone who's going to change but work with both sides. And Peggy Neely came out as someone who voted for City North but now doesn't like developers.
Yeah, so. I'd agree. I mean, there was no clear winner. There was no singular moment that you could really, you know, that grabbed headlines or anything like that. But there clearly did emerge, though, that, like, it, you know, you alluded to, two different camps, one for the status quo, one who wanted to shake that status quo.
Well, it's really two races. I mean, Stanton, everybody thinks, is going to be in the runoff. He's the Democrat in the race, even though it's nonpartisan. He's going to get all the Democratic and more liberal votes. And then you got the rest of the folks going in this kind of Republican primary to try to win this. And there's a lot of dynamics there. And I think that Claude's biggest challenge is he doesn't come across as very Republican. And it's just he's backed by the firefighter union. He's a nice guy. But you don't look at him and think Republican like maybe you think some of the other candidates.
One thing I find interesting, Ted, about this race, because we always cover congressional races so much, the gubernatorial race between Goddard and Brewer. Phoenix, being a large city, is really a center-left city. Maricopa County is not center-left, but the city of Phoenix is. And it's interesting to finally have a race like this where a guy like Stanton might actually be the favorite in November, where he never would be if Maricopa County were voting.
It'll be interesting to see, too, once we have a runoff field decided, the number one and number two, how the Republican Party is going to handle it. Because up till now, they've been kind of quiet, been under the radar, because you have a bunch of Republicans, you know, running against Stanton at this point. But once it's a Republican-Democrat, even though it's nonpartisan, where do they come down? Mm-hmm. Where does the money go? How much can someone like a Gullett or a Neely or Matt, how much can they raise now? Because they've been all kind of competing with the same donors for this limited amount of money. When they get into this runoff election, it's just going
to
be them.
I think to Steve's point, the Republicans don't know how to run this campaign. Phoenix is moderate. It's 42% Hispanic. It's not pro 1070. You can't run that Jan Brewer high ground immigration race that you ran statewide. And so they're having a hard time with figuring out what do we go after Stanton?
And this is why I think the Stanton campaign fears running against Wes Gullett more than they would anybody else, because Wes has been known for years as a rhino, which is Republican in name only. I mean, heck, he was on the Republicans for Janet Napolitano back in 2006. He's a moderate Republican out there who, you know, doesn't have a history of throwing a, you know, being too extreme. So I think, you know, if you look at the field, if you're standing, who do you at least want to run against? I think it's Gullett.
All right, let's move on. Scott Bungard pleads no contest to a misdemeanor endangerment. He's got to go through, within a year, mm-hmm. some sort of a domestic violence program. If he doesn't finish that, then we got a whole new set of concerns here. Talk about this.
The most interesting development for me is that I think people expected this to be settled, is what happens now in the state Senate. Senator Leo Landrum Taylor, who had initially filed an ethics complaint against Scott Bungard, said, okay, the justice system has done its job, I'm going to pull out. But Senate Ethics Chair Ron Gould has said, wait a second, now because he admitted to guilt, no contest, we may have to proceed with something on this, though he's going to wait a few weeks, is what he has said. That's the most interesting development to me. Is Gould going to say, okay, I actually fit this position as an ethics chairman, and party doesn't matter?
Well, I was going to say, is this a way for the Democrats to say, hey, we're just going to make a Republican go ahead and go after another Republican? It sounds like that's what's going on.
And that's what does sound what's going on. But Mr. Gould, apparently, he was telling people initially that, yeah, this is going to happen. You know, I'm going to do it one way or the other. If I have to do it myself, it's going to happen. But now I hear that he's starting to walk that back a little bit, saying it may not be appropriate for me to go ahead and do that. I may have to wait for somebody. So that somebody could end up being someone like a Senator Steve Gallardo, someone like that is going to call for this ethics committee, which is just going to be a circus when it happens.
What kind of weight does Scott Bungard have next session? I mean,
yeah, very little, I would imagine. I mean, I think he's pretty much a lame duck. I don't think there's a lot of weight. I think a lot of people down there, just especially on the Republican side, just want this to go away. So there's probably some impetus on Gould to lay off and let's just move on.
We had an interesting idea for U.S. Senate. A former Surgeon General of the United States might just throw his hat into the ring. Talk to us about this.
Richard Carmona, who's based in Tucson, who I think a lot of people would have assumed was a Republican because he served as Surgeon General during the George W. Bush administration, says he's been an independent his whole career, says he has people in the Democratic Party asking him to run, which to me, Dennis has heard this joke before, it's like when you're at a party, my friends think I'm funny. Now, are people really telling him? Is it just a couple of people telling him to run? But the Democrats need someone. At this point, Democratic Party Chair Don Bivens, the only one. I spoke with Congressman Raul Grijalva a week or two ago, and he said he's not going to run. He is kind of hedging. He doesn't think Gabby Giffords should run, but the Democrats need someone. Maybe it's Carmona.
Is a Carmona a hefty candidate here? Does a Carmona make an impact on this race?
I think he can if he gets in. That's the big if. We've covered politics in the state for a long time, and his name is not a new name to be floated out there for a race, because he is an ideal candidate for something like this. He's got the last name out there. He's got the great resume. He is somebody who could make a real challenge and be a serious threat to somebody on the Republican side. But, you know, we're still a long ways from him getting in the race because we've been here before.
Well, he's got a compelling personal story. I think he was like the doctor on the SWAT team for Pima County. I want to say he has military experience.
He does.
You know, he knows how to speak. He's been out there, you know, in a lot of public speaking roles as Surgeon General. The question is, does he want to raise money? And can he pull the trigger on this in a state that's very, very Republican right now? And how much national support from Democrats is he going to get in Arizona? Are we going to be a target state for somebody to come and say, okay, we got a chance here, or are they going to try to defend other seats?
For someone who's never run for any campaign, as far as I know, to start with the U.S. Senate, kind of daunting. Look what happened to Jim Peterson. It didn't work out too well for him.
Yeah. Before we go, I want to talk about the Fed's this case-by-case basis regarding illegal. I thought this was a very big story and something that is going to reverberate for quite a while. What do you think about the reverberations here in Arizona politics? Already the governor's come out and said this is backdoor amnesty, and Sheriff Arpaio is not happy with the situation. The idea of the government concentrating on the worst of the worst, the serious violent criminals, as opposed to those with no criminal record for deportation, that's a big deal.
It is a big deal. It sounds like something Attorney General Eric Holder had wanted to do from the beginning. If you look at Arizona politics, I think this is something that Republicans will jump on and say, okay, this is President Obama trying to offer amnesty. If you look at it in a practical way, it may in fact make sense, but in a political sense, it will not.
What do you think about this? I mean, obviously this is something that the Republicans could jump on if they want to. Do they want to?
Yeah, I mean, yeah. Do you alienate Hispanic voters even more? Wouldn't you think that the Bush administration and the Clinton administration would have been doing this already? You know, you're going to go after a drug cartel guy or someone that you picked up at a restaurant or construction site. So, but I think this is all politics. I think this is good politics in terms of reaching out to Hispanics for the Obama administration. It's probably good politics for Jan Brewer in Arizona. Is it good politics for Republicans going forward in states like Nevada and California and Texas? I don't know, because you're going to come across as anti-Hispanic.
But what about states like Arizona? I mean, is this the kind of thing you can hit your wagon to if you're a Republican and just say, thank you, President Obama?
You know, if you're a Republican and you're looking at what people have done in the past, you know, you say to yourself, if it ain't broke, you know, why fix it? You know, a lot of people have been elected over the past few years running on, you know, get tough on immigration measures. You know, this gives them another soundbite to use because, you know, what they're going to say is if you're going to focus on people who don't, you know, you allow people to stay here who don't have criminal backgrounds, they're going to say, well, they do have a criminal background. They broke the law when they came here illegally.
Well, Obama's under a lot of pressure because he hasn't come through for his constituencies very much on a lot of things. Folks on the left, Hispanic folks that voted for him nationally, you know, haven't gotten what they want. Immigration reform is not going to go anywhere with the type of Congress and situation we have now. So this is kind of a bone to throw to those folks and say, look, we're going to go after the criminals. We're not going to go after the people that are here working.
Are you surprised that there wasn't more of a hue and cry over this?
I was. I think there will develop, to be, as we get closer to 2012, there's no mm-hmm. question there will be. But it is funny when Mike mentions the politics of it, because it does seem as if President Obama is kind of pandering to the Hispanic community. But as we know, let's use the term monolith, Hispanic voters are not monolithic. They don't all vote the same way. There are some people who are third and fourth generation Americans who don't like the fact that there are some people who've come across illegally.
Well, you saw Grijalva come out and say he liked it, not surprisingly. But a lot of folks in Congress are in shell shock. They're hiding right now because everybody's mad at them over the debt ceiling and over the economy. So I think both sides are kind of laying low right now. So that's why you only saw, you know, Governor Brewer come out on the Republican side.
I was going to add to the monolithic comment. They're also not big in voter turnout either, is the other thing you got to remember. I mean, we're not talking about a big block of voters out there that have come out yet. I mean, there's the potential there. It's been out there for years. And this could be something to get them out to the polls, or a few more out to the polls in 2012.
All right. Good stuff, guys. Thanks for joining us. We appreciate it. Monday on Horizon. Is the Valley a good place for business? If so, why? If not, then what needs to be improved? And we'll look at how the feds are funding renewable energy in rural Arizona. That's Monday evening at 7 on Horizon. Tuesday, the politics of Arizona's redistricting process. Wednesday, we look at reports that indicate a decline in illegal immigration. Thursday, an art exhibit featuring sculptures of light. And Friday, we are back with another edition of the Journalists Roundtable. Washington Week is next. That is it for now. I'm Ted Simons. Thank you so much for joining us. You have a great weekend.